from the MCPLive.tv studios, located in downtown Conroe. It's the Conroe Art League, live.
Hello and welcome to Cal Live, the show that introduces you to the many talented artists of the Conroe Art League and to the beautiful art that they create. My name is Ken Roy. I'm the president of the Art League, and I'm your host today. And my guest today is Ed Gorman. Ed is a longtime member of the Art League, does a lot around the Art League, and we'll talk about some of those things that you do, Ed, above and beyond the art. And one of the first persons that I met when I joined the Art League, and was kind enough to sit down with me when I was going on the board as the chair of shows and exhibitions, and sat down and gave me somewhat of a rundown, or an overview, some suggestions on how to do a show and what objectives and goals to have. So Ed, if I never thanked you for that, thanks. Ed does a number of things, as I said, art-wise, photography, and in the past year, another art form, which I'm going to call pouring or pourer, but I'll let Ed explain that. But for now, Ed, if you could catch us up, you're not a native Texan. Could you catch us up where you're originally from, and how did you get to Texas? And of course, Ed lives in Conroe with his lovely wife, Sherry. So give us some background, Ed.
I really grew up in Wisconsin and was transferred to Kansas City in 1982 with a company, and then on to Texas in 85. So as they say, I got here as fast as I could. And in 1988, I started my own company on the west side of Houston, and we started coming up to Conroe. And about 94, we moved to Conroe, Montgomery first, and then now we've lived in the city of Conroe the last 5 years, I guess.
Yeah, very good, very good. So Ed, you're a photographer. Why photography? What brought you to that? Did you ever draw? Did you ever paint? Did you ever do anything else? Just jumped into photography? When and why?
I have no formal art training at all. I've never taken an art class, probably in grade school, but not beyond that. And like many people, I started with digital Super 8 film in the early 70s, doing just family stuff. Never gave photography a thought as a hobby, really. It was just a matter of recording the family activities. And then in the early 80s, I bought a couple of mini 35 millimeter film cameras to travel with. I was enthralled with miniature everything at the time. And again, took pictures just to record the moment. I had no interest at all in doing anything other than that. And then as I approached retirement and I started to look for things to do to take up some of my time and things that maybe would challenge me to create something or learn the mechanics, and I chose photography, partially because you can do it inexpensively. You could also do it real expensively. And I never had any aspirations of shooting for National Geographic. So I started out with a small pocket camera, a DSLR at the time, and then grew. It seemed like every year I had outgrown the camera. And I bought my first DSLR back, I guess, about 2005, a Canon 5D Mark II. Which was new technology at the time. And since then, every couple of years, I change my camera body out to get closer to the latest technology.
And DSL is for the rest of us, Ed. DSL is what? Digital?
Digital imaging, yes. The DSLR is the latest variant to the terminology. And now the newest is mirrorless cameras. Mirrorless cameras are now all the rage. Most all the manufacturers are now coming out with mirrorless cameras. Some manufacturers were a little bit behind the curve and it took them a little longer to do it, but all the major manufacturers now promote the mirrorless first. So the DSLRs are fading.
Okay, when and I want to go back to the Super 8. That's holding
the
little camera,
Sony hand
and
camera.
The kids are playing in the pool,
that's,
or they're running down the street.
That's
you're
exactly
taking
right. So I have all these reels at home.
Still have
spliced
them.
Spliced together, like 400 feet at a time. Still have them. I've had them now converted to digital,
that
so I now have them
question.
On a DVD, so they're watchable. And I must admit, they're horrible.
Yeah. I remember seeing some of those after they taken. Everybody's walking real fast, and of course, everybody's smiling, waving at the camera.
The only thing is that they are horrible. Truthfully, as I've now progressed to recognizing photography and imaging and things like that, they're horrible. But I have to say, it preserved families.
Yes. Yes.
That there are no other images of people that have long since passed away, so they're invaluable.
Yes.
And I would say to anybody starting photography, and all of the new cameras today do excellent video. You take it because in years from now, you'll enjoy it.
That's right. Now, going back, Ed, to the day of film, did you actually have a dark room and do the processing?
I never did the darkroom thing at all. What I would do is, like most people, is I would take my 12 shots or 24 shots down to Walgreens and get them developed. And I've got a box full of now 4x6 prints with two strips of negatives that are sort of useless. So again, those I've been converting on to DVDs so I can now import them into the computer and use them just as though it was a brand new picture out of my DSLR.
Did you, at any time when you were doing that, did you work closely with someone who did finish, or was it always the camera store back in the day to get that, input of make this lighter, this darker, bring that out, or just was it accept whatever
no,
came?
No, I out? Was just the average customer that had no clue what he was doing, and I was happy to get 6 out of 12 that were somewhat in focus. So I never worked with anybody that retouched, developed, dodged and burned. I just took it out and never framed a picture. They just sat around. And as time went on recently, I developed a like, I guess I won't call it love yet, for the old film style in the medium format cameras, which I now have. And I use, mainly the idea was to use them for black and white panorama landscapes. So I still do some, but again, I will take that image and move it into the 21st generation on the computer.
Was there any loss? Like, I'm not a photographer, but I've had the 35 and the Instamatic and all, and then we moved to the digital with the phones and the camera. But is there any loss of feeling like it's really easy to take another one? If I don't get that shot, so what? But back with the regular camera and the film, my imagination, or did you actually have to think about it and plan a shot? And boy, if you missed it, which you may not know.
Well, the film cameras that I had were relatively simple to operate. There were very few choices, but you always looked beyond the cost of the film to the cost of printing. So you did not, at least I did not, take multiple images of things like I do now. One of the pictures that we'll pull up in a minute, I probably took 100 images of this one flower before I chose one to work on in the computer.
Oh, good. Now, other than the Conroe Art League, I think you're involved in a lot of photography clubs.
I belong to two photography clubs that are down in the Woodlands. I'll give them a plug. One is the Woodlands Photography Club. One is the Woodlands Camera Club. They both have excellent websites. They are both in the same price range to join as Cal is. They both hold monthly meetings. There is a little bit of difference between the programming between the two, but there's a lot of overlap in membership between the two clubs. I'm not unusual in belonging to both clubs. And they have a general meeting each month with a speaker, and most of the time the speakers are very good. A lot of them are travelogues, honestly, but I would recommend anybody that has an interest in photography to go to their websites. Again, it's the Woodlands Camera Club or the Woodlands Photography Club.
How do you think, Cal, and by the way, folks, Ed mentioned joining $40 a year to join the Conroe Art League.
That may be more expensive than the photography clubs.
Is that right? Okay. How do you, I see some photographers, I wish there were more at the Conroe Art League, that don't seem to have the critical mass, of course, that painters do, but maybe that's just the way the world is. But is that accurate perception, or should we have more photographers in the
club? Well, when I joined about 10 years ago, there were very few active photographers in the club. There were people that took pictures because a lot of people will take a picture and then they'll paint from their own picture. But there weren't a lot of photographers exhibiting in the gallery or exhibiting in our shows. So, and at one time, and I still sort of count when we hang, we have about 20% of the volume is photography today. And we have some very good photographers that are in the club now. We have also overlapped members of the camera clubs that belong to Cal, and we've got Cal members that, like myself, that belong to the photography clubs. The when I started 10 years ago, and I hate to say this, but I used to call it the Old Ladies Painting Club, and to some extent it still is. So photographers were sort of on the outside. You know, we were something else. It wasn't technical, it wasn't art, and you know, and on and on. So yes, I would like to see more photographers exhibit and show.
And you help with some of that because you offer free lessons. I know it's a Thursday. I forget if it's the first, the second, or is it both Thursdays?
The first Thursday of the month, I'm at the gallery from opening to close. My preference is that you send me an email or contact me somehow and set up an appointment, and we'll spend about an hour together. And most of the people that come in have a new camera, or they want me to recommend a camera, or they just don't even know how to turn on the camera. So I am not a camera expert by any means, but we sit down and we spend time. The first question I ask is, what do you want to take pictures of? And then I try to set up the camera to do that. And we'll have them take some test pictures, teach them how to hold the camera, how to turn it on, how to work some of the dials, set some of the settings. So when they leave after about an hour, they've really had enough of me. They've absorbed as much as they could possibly absorb. And I have, what my favorite story is, I've got two girls that have been coming in now for over a year. They're sisters. They share a camera. They have different interests. And they come in and they've now they're downloading onto their laptop, and they're using some aftermarket software to work on their pictures, and they're quite good. And one of them has shown in our local shows, and the other one has been sending in things to online shows. So they've developed an entrance, and they've, in my mind, they've really come a long way with their compositions and their understanding how to set up their own camera.
That's good to know. And thanks for doing that, Ed. You do something that I find interesting. You'll pack up your bags, you'll pack up your camera, and you'll go somewhere to take, photography safari. Can you tell us about one or two of those trips?
Well, the one I know you like is the one with a couple of members, good photographers at Cal, and that I've become friends with. And they said, we have to go out and shoot someday. And I said, oh, yeah, well, fine. You know, set up the date. We're going to go out and shoot peeling paint. Well, if you've ever watched paint dry, this is the opposite of that. So you go to these old, worn-out, empty buildings, and you shoot a little square of peeling paint. Boy, this is going to be really boring. And we did it all day long.
And was it boring?
Well, no, because we were with good friends, and the food, lunch was good, and we had a good time. And we joked about it all day long, and they teased me in that. But at the end of the day, the pictures that came out from all three of us, we had some good shots. And in today's world of photography, where everybody has a camera, you need, if you're going to be an artist, You need to figure out to take pictures of something like that, because everybody takes a picture of the sunrise or the sunset. And after a while, those get really boring. So when I go up to a picture today, or I'm standing in the gallery watching people walk around, if they stop at a picture and they can say, I've never seen anything like that before, you've made an impression. And that's the goal.
And I know another trip that you took that I like, because you went to my part of the country, is to the Atchafalaya Basin. The name of the piece you did, the Cajun Mafia Graveyard?
Yes, Cemetery. Cajun Mafia Cemetery.
No, don't send any letters, folks. Cajun Mafia was Atchafalaya Basin, beautiful shot below the I-10, which goes across the basin.
I was in an airboat.
Doing the trip, took it there. So nice shot of that. Well, let's look at the art.
Let's look at the photography.
Let's bring up number one. Let me take a look at it, and I'll make a comment, and then we'll go on to the next one. And this one, Sherry's Orchid, right?
Yes.
And that's sold at the reception this past Saturday. It was hanging in, no, it was actually, it was determined to be the People's Choice Award for the previous month. So we gave the award in July for showing in June. So folks, each month, almost every month, we have a People's Choice Award guest and members come into the gallery, and they vote one time for the piece that they like. And Sherry's Orchid was the piece. And you've also had some honors of getting the banner. I won't go into that award right now, but Sherry's Orchid. So tell us about that. That is a dramatic piece. See it in person.
Yeah, this piece, my wife Sherry received it as a present for either Mother's Day or her birthday. They're very close together, and I don't remember which. But when my daughter-in-law brought it in and I looked at it, I said, this is really cool. So I took it out to my garage studio, hung up the black cloth background on the workbench, and this is the one where I said earlier I probably took 100 pictures of it. I used 3 different lenses, different aperture settings, different lighting, different angles, until I found one that I felt I liked. And it's a little bit different. And that piece is printed on canvas. It is 36 inches tall and is 12 inches wide. And when I started the process, I knew what I wanted to print and I knew the size I wanted to print. So now I had to take the photograph to match those specs. So that photograph is actually a panorama. It's a stitched together, 2 pictures stitched together to make it. So when I take pictures of inanimate objects that are in the size range, particularly flowers, I like to print them their actual live size. So that replicates really the size of what the original was.
Oh, that's very nice. So you stitched together 2 pieces, panoramic, and that vertical, which I think maybe that was the first time I saw you do a vertical, or the first time I noticed that you had that vertical orientation to
right.
it. And it was dramatic, I thought.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. I enjoy printing. A lot of photographers today, they don't print anything. The people at the photography club, it drives me nuts. You go down there and they'll have their mini shows every month where you show your pictures, show and tell. And these guys will spend 6 or 8 hours retouching a picture that they never, ever print. My house is full of all my own work. I love to print my work, and I love what I would call larger sizes. And I love to find something that's a little different. A few years ago, we had a contest where everybody took a picture of a glass pot and a teapot, and I did that and I hung it on the wall. And then behind the picture, I hung these fragrance packets. So when you walked up in front of my picture, it smelled. But it smelled good.
It smelled good.
So okay. The picture is the same picture as 50 other pictures, but when you walked up in front of mine, it smelled different.
Right. Okay, let's go to the next one, if we could. And this one, I know, I remember that one, and I looked at it, and I said, well, that's interesting, and I'll let you tell the story of what makes it a little bit different, because when you told me how you did it, I said, you did what?
Well,
how could you do that?
When the COVID started, your photography somewhat gets limited as to how far you can walk around your house. So you can't do much. And one night I was watching Google and I saw this lady do these acrylic pours on canvas. And I looked at that and I says, that's really cool. So I now have a degree from UT, YouTube, on how do you pour acrylic paint. And I enjoyed the mechanics of figuring out how to do it, how to do it different, how to sort of combine some of the things that I had seen. So that particular piece is 36 inches tall again and 12 inches wide. And I put ribbons of paint down on the canvas. And then I took a wet paper towel and swiped it to get the background. Then I let it dry. Then I used about 6 feet of what I'd call jewelry chain, squiggled it all over, dab paint things, and then you pull the chain out, and that's what I got.
And so you're putting the red, you're putting the white,
you're placing it,
hoping when you do the paper
towel.
You
have no idea what you're going to get.
And then when you come back, so let me ask you this. You do the paper towel. If you like what you see, you still do the jewelry chain. Or if you don't like what you see, the jewelry chain is next to fix it.
Yeah. That's the beauty of this type of painting, in that I would recommend anybody that wants to do something creative on a budget, you could go down to one of the art stores and buy a packet of 12 by 12 canvases. They end up costing about $2 a piece. And a six pack of beginning acrylic pour paints, and watch a couple of videos, and you can have all kinds of fun. If they don't turn out, you paint over them. If they really don't turn out, you throw them away. You don't have a lot of money invested. You just have to watch some videos, because it is messy. But I've had a ball doing it.
And this one, too, was a panoramic that you had to take at least a couple and stitch it together. Or that's not.
No,
really
I actually just took one. Picture of that.
Okay.
The panorama that I did on the photography was more, again, experimental. I like to experiment trying to find different ways to find the same end. And so that was a little different. I had never heard of anybody taking a panorama of a single plant. So I've done it.
Well, when I first saw the one with the wet paper towels and the chain, I didn't know that was the process. And I said, wow, Ed's painting now. He's picking up the brush and he's got a palette and he's going to town painting the flowers. And you did, just in not a way
there
that I would have expected.
Never a brush touched the canvas.
Never a brush touched a canvas.
Yeah.
And we can expect to see more of that type of
work?
Well,
the other thing I do now is I've got some young grandchildren. So I've got a 7-year-old now and a 13-year-old. And for a couple of years, so backdate the ages, we'll go out to the garage and I'll have them pick their canvas, mix their paints, pick the way they want to pour it, and they make their own art. And both of them have exhibited at Cal. Both of them have gotten ribbons in the school divisions. And both of them have sold artwork at the gallery. And they enjoy doing it too. So I've also got the neighbor grandchildren coming over to do it. So it's just something that is fun. I enjoy teaching the kids, and I've made some really bad stuff. And I've made some stuff, like Ken is saying, on this one. I've never seen anything like that before, and that's my goal.
And the ribbons and the awards that Ed references comes from the Lone Star Art Guild show, LSAG, which does have a division for children, elementary, middle school, and high school. So that's a good plug there to give exposure to the children, teenagers that are doing art.
Oh, the kids have a ball doing it. They said, you know, Papa, when's the next show? I've got to get my piece ready for the next show. So they're into it.
Coming up, we hope.
Yes.
And let's bring up the last piece. And I'm going to comment, it just looks like a lot of texture. I like the color of the pink and the black, the green, but tell us about that one, Ed.
Well, this is called Knotted Rack, which I can either tell you what that means or you can Google what it means. And that is a 24-inch square of PDF that I've put a frame around. So I built the frame and then I covered it with drywall compound and used a trowel to get the pattern. Then I let it dry for about a week or better. And then I mixed art resin in a pot, and then I think I used 4 or 5 colors. So I then used the tint from art resin and made the individual things. And you pour it on, and then you swish it around, and you have no idea how it's going to turn out. You can't control where the paint is going to go. But when it was all said and done, people came over and looked at it and said, that's pretty cool.
Pretty good.
Yeah, so I left it. And for those of you that didn't have any success at Google, knotted wreck is a form of seaweed.
Oh, interesting. Did you do anything to the joint compound once it dried? Did you sand it? Did you carve it? Oh, I guess you can't carve it, but you could cut it in places to change it? Or did you just accept what happened?
I didn't do anything. I accepted what happened, and this is a learning process. And the drywall compound will crack just because it's so thick, I think. And I left the cracks because it added texture. So some people will say, guy doesn't know what he's doing, you know, and I say, no, it adds texture.
That's the art, yeah. Ed, thanks for talking about those three pieces. Talk a little bit about what you do, because I think this is an art in itself in our monthly shows. And we do a monthly show at the Art League. Our members come in, they take out what's on the wall, they bring in new pieces to display on the wall, and you can see some of those pieces behind. But that's an art in itself, I think, to take all the art that comes in, because we could get 40, maybe 50 pieces of art.
Right.
What's some of the things that, how do you approach that, and what's important to get that art on the wall? It's not just an accident.
You know, no.
Throwing it on the wall, well, see what sticks.
Well, we have a hanging committee that's made up of 4, 5, 6 people, depending upon how you count or who's there. And I've been doing this now for probably 7 or 8 years, so I sort of have got a mental feel as to how I would like the wall to look when we're finished. But the problem is you never know the size art that's coming in, the color of the art that's coming in, the color of the frame. You just have no clue. So the goal is to try and get a wall that is pleasing to look at and have maybe some symmetry to it, working within what you've got. So I've gotten better at it. It doesn't take us near as long as it used to. And we get a lot of compliments, I think, from people coming in as to how the gallery looks. And we've got a good crew that hangs. It doesn't take, like I said, doesn't take us near as long as it used to do it. The last few months we've been in the 35 piece range. We could easily, generally, unless they're all 48 inches wide, hang 50 or 60 pieces, which I would love to see more pieces hang in the gallery. But we get them from smaller than 12 by 12 to 48 by 84. We have one artist that loves these giant pieces, and
right.
Every time I get one of those pieces, it creates a real problem because they're normally bright colors and it's hard to get something to put next to it that's just not going to look weird. So it's challenging, and normally I'll sit on the bench and look at the wall and say no, and we'll make some changes.
Right.
And I've even come back the next day before opening and made changes, but it's something fun to do. Everybody that's been doing it has been doing it for a while now, and we get along well. We don't fight about how it's going to end up.
And you do a nice job, and we've had judges, for example, on our national shows. These are judges that are not a part of the Conroe Art League. They come in and they're very impressed and very complimentary of what you do. And even one thing I know is our members can submit up to 3 pieces per show, but you wouldn't want all 3 of the pieces for that one artist together because the style may be similar and it wouldn't have variety. So that's another thing that you have to...
I agree with that basic concept, but sometimes you get stuck with the cards that you're dealt. And last month or the month before, we had one artist bring in three pieces. They were identically framed, identically the same size, the same type of images. And I decided to hang them almost like it was a triptych. And we got compliments on that. And then sometimes if you get, I've run into it particularly with photography, that the photographer will use the same frame, the same mat with images. But when you're trying to balance a wall, I'll put one to the left and one to the right and something in the middle. So they're closer together than you like, but you have to work within what you've got. And yes, by the way, when we do this, I do not look at the name of the artist or the name of the piece, so we try not to favor anybody. Now, I have to be honest and say there are some artists that when they bring in their work, I know whose it is because it's different or the same, you know. But we try not to favor any artist. I try to make the gallery look as good as I can make it with what comes in that month.
And you do a good job. And thank you for that, Ed. And to see Ed's art, I think the only place you can see it except in a private collection in a home is at the Conroe Art League. So to see Ed's art as well as the art of the other members of the Art League, please visit us at the Best Little Art Gallery in historic downtown Conroe. We're at 127 Simonton Street. We're open Tuesday through Saturday from 11 to 4. Join us there, please, to create, appreciate, and learn.